Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE here at our New York Stock Exchange studio on the East Coast. Obviously, this is where we have all the action on Wall Street. Of course, we've got Palo Alto studio and Wall Street connecting tech and Silicon Valley together. Money, tech, culture is the big focus right now. And the AWS Summit was this week. It's also theCUBE's media week around cloud and AI. The top story is how these agents are going to be put to work, how code's getting into production. Obviously, automated coding, you're starting to see all the kinds of toolings, the governance, all these things that are really hard to do in the cloud and on-prem, actually, for distributed computing and hybrid cloud are all the key. And data is the key, and we love synthetic data as it's used a lot in anything from automotive, all kinds of scenarios, digital twins, to also understanding how data can behave and be modeled. We've got a great guest, Grant DeLeeuw, co-founder and CEO of DataMasque, here all the way from New Zealand, in town for the AWS Summit. Grant, thanks you for coming in to the studio, your little New York Stock Exchange, center of capitalism.
Thanks, John. Great to be here. What an awesome sight to get behind the scenes at Stock Exchange.
Thanks for coming in. Really great. Again, we're just continuing our version of a digital twin, which is the events over with AWS. We're continuing to, in our studio, keep it going because the demand is so high for AI native, AI capabilities because of the obvious business reasons, reduces costs, save times, drives new revenue, just multitude of benefits, okay? But there's a lot of action going on with a lot of the kind of the technical and business model transformations. For example, do I have enough data? What do I do with my data? I got to understand it first and then figure, okay, once I know what it is, what's the architecture? I'm on Amazon, I got VPCs, do I create a horizontally? Which services do I turn on? How do I create a new platform to build it,
yeah,
and then have vertical domain expertise that scales? I mean, these are like, I mean, it sounds easy, but that's the core problem.
Yeah, absolutely, and doing it in a safe and secure way. So obviously AWS takes privacy and security extremely seriously. And one of the challenges that a lot of large enterprises and regulated industries are struggling with is how do we leverage the customer data in a safe and secure manner?
Well, Grant, I'm glad you're here because not only is it ironic that you're in from New Zealand, I know you're gonna jump on a flight out later, tomorrow or tonight, is that you're a global startup, okay?
Yes.
Most of the times, the old pattern was, oh, Silicon Valley, two guys in a garage, two guys in a dorm room, guy and a gal, they build this product, they grow, they get some funding. You guys are a global startup.
Yes.
Okay, and with AWS as a big partner. Take us through how you guys are organized, one, and what you do, because we're in an era now where you don't have to have 200 people to have a global presence. You guys have global presence here in the US and international, and you're like less than 30 people.
Yeah, so it's AWS has given us the opportunity to be able to leverage Marketplace globally. And so small team in New Zealand, 5 million people. This is always was going to be global from day one. And so we've built the business that way. And so Marketplace has allowed us to be able to transact and find customers in places that we haven't had boots on the ground. So you know, take the US as an example. We're coming out to 12 months where we've put our first person on the ground here, but we had some significant sales with large Fortune 100 customers here in New York when we had no people on the ground.
And Marketplace is a dream scenario. I mean, the business just is a cash register ringing. No sales reps.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, because it does reduce cost, but it allowed us to sort of get the customers first before then building a team behind it.
And so now you're supporting more customers. So you've got a field presence.
That's right.
Time zone challenges.
Correct.
Serving customers, getting market needs.
100%. And it's to better support the customers, to help our growth in market as well. Not all customers want to deal with someone on the other side of the world.
You know, someone to be doing your Zooms at 3 a.m, right?
I mean, like, I've done a few of those in my time. And Americans love a Friday afternoon meeting, which is Saturday morning my time, but things you do.
Yeah, so what do you guys do? Let's get into the product, because one of the things I'm fascinated by is, besides the global startups, I think that's going to be a playbook that's going to continue, is that you're in a very important area right now where you look at robotics, AI factories, or even kind of the physical AI world, synthetic data is being used a lot in many different use cases, something that you guys specialize in.
Yes.
Talk about what you do. What is the product and why does it exist? What problem are you solving?
Yeah, absolutely. So the the problem we're solving is where enterprises want to leverage their customer data. So synthetic data is great for model training and can be used for, as you're saying, for weights and biases around certain models. But often the real value is actually in the customer data. But the challenge these organizations have is still falls under the privacy, data security, data sovereignty. And so do you really want to be testing your AI agents or your LLM chatbot on real customer data? And so what DataMasque solves for is we do a dark site deployment into the client's private zone of their data. So we're not asking them to send it outside of their secure zone. And we will imitate their customer data, but create in a synthetic way. And so what that allows the organizations to do is actually create synthetically identical customer data that they can then use for development, training, testing your AI agents before you roll it
out. Is it a complete replica of the data, or is you masking out like key privacy codes or other?
Yeah, so
that work?
We will identify PII, health information, credit card information, and then we'll make a recommendation as to how to protect that information. And then once that's been agreed and been signed off by the customer, we will create that synthetically identical data where that sensitive data was. The rest of the data is actually identical. And one of the key values of DataMasque, the fact that we actually mask down to a field level. So we're creating high fidelity synthetic data.
So you get the benefit of that private information, but even if it was leaked or anything, yeah, it's not workable.
There's no data breach. There's no data sovereignty. But you get the edge cases, and that's what's super important.
Give an example of the edge case. What would be
edge case? Every enterprise has very messy data, so it could be the date of births, first of the first 1900. How's an agent going to react to that sort of information that's actually in the customer data set, or two different types of addresses there that are conflicting? It's that messiness of the data that exists in every single enterprise that you actually need to test and train these AI models on, and particularly AI agents, so you actually understand how they're going to behave. If you're trying to test on perfect data.
No one's got perfect data.
No one's got perfect data.
I mean, data cleaning has been an industry and everyone hates it, but you got to clean the data. You want clean data. That's the goal.
Yep. But as soon as you connect your AI agents to your existing data stores, it's not going to be
dirty data, dirty agents. I mean, bad agents,
bad data in, bad data out.
So talk about the use case again. So take me through. So the customers want to get that data, they want to train agents on it, and the outcome is what? Smarter agents knowing how to handle situations.
Yeah, well, 70% of testing done for agents is still by humans. So people need to look at that data. So there's still privacy.
Yeah.
The same problem exists now is you can't have your AI engineers looking at customer data, and you can't have agents running on that data for the risk of what actually could occur.
A lot of people I talk to, I ask them, because what's your data strategy? These are very big companies.
Yeah.
And they have plenty of data departments. They got databases, they're well done. So when I ask them what their AI innovation strategy is, the real candid answers, if they're being honest, and they are, they say, honestly, we're just trying to figure out what we have.
Yes.
What do we do? So it's not like they have some prescription. Yeah, RAG and search, that's easy.
Yeah.
I want to find something faster. There's literally no brainer on that. But when you want to get a competitive advantage and get the value out of the data and unlock real value, the first step is like, what did we got? I mean, not what data types. It's like, what we don't know what to do.
What is the value in our
data? Is it that we could do with it?
Yeah.
Like, let's understand it.
Yeah, exactly.
That is where everyone is right now.
Yeah, 100%. And so a lot of these models have been trained on all the public data that's out there, or a whole bunch of synthetic. The value is actually the data behind the firewall. And as you say, there's some new use case. We're speaking with some large retail banks, and they have over 100 AI use cases that they've lined up that involve customer data. They're actually blocked because they don't know how to test it before they roll it out.
Yeah, so they're stuck.
Exactly.
So you unlock there. You're like the airport, TSA pre-global entry. So give me some examples of some engagements you've had. You don't have to name names, but just anonymize the customers. But what is some of the core examples? Can you share stories?
Absolutely. So, where we started our business was before the AI wave, and so we're solving for predominantly dev and test environments. So where organizations need high quality synthetic data in their lower environments. Development testing, the idea being that you shouldn't be testing on customer data, so same applies for AI, and you need that high fidelity, so you are introducing bugs during testing and development, not when you roll it out to production. So we've done that for large enterprises, so yeah, Fortune 100 that's based here in New York, very large payroll company, ADP, which is actually a case study, I can talk about that one, employers and workers compensation, also a case study customer. So that's solving.
How are those engagements going? I mean, take me through a day in the life. What happens? You engage with them and do they participate?
Yeah, so that they typically have reached out to DataMasque or AWS saying, we've got this problem where we need, we've found sensitive data in our lower environments. There might have been some sort of security issue and they're needing to solve a problem around that. And so we're working typically with AWS to deploy DataMasque into their environment, do the scan, identify what's sensitive, and then we now then get integrated into their data provisioning pipeline. So every time they're doing a refresh, we're allowing that the DataMasque does the de-identification, creates the synthetically identical data, and then that's what's passed.
So it's usually the first strike or the first opportunity is on some sort of event or identified security or messy thing that's out there.
That's right. But where that's changed in the last sort of 3 to 6 months is organizations have blocked with some of their AI use cases because of the customer data element. So you can introduce ones to write better code internally, take better meeting notes, that's all fine. But when it's actually involving customer data or interacting with the customer, significantly more
so,
testing. So
either the security thing or they're actually leaning into a plan.
Yes.
And correct. They need to...
Or they're blocked.
They're just
simply blocked. They're like, the privacy team is saying, no, you can't use customer data for this. The risk is too great. Just straight synthetic data doesn't have the realism of the production customer data they need.
So you're identifying a trend that right now, if someone wants to do stuff with the customer data, most likely it'll be messy or blocked or some sort of challenge. And the answer is just synthetically create it and go there.
Exactly right. So
that's the playbook.
That's the playbook. So you use your customer data to create synthetically identical customer data, maintains relationships, referential integrity. All the ugliness of your production data is what it should be.
I mean, that's an industry trend.
Yes.
Like, that's the move. What about competition? You must have competition.
Oh, absolutely. So we've got...
I mean, that's the market right there.
But I think the advantage DataMasque has over our competition is the fact that we've been designed for enterprise from day one. And so we're not SaaS. We're not asking customers to send their customer data into... our environment is an example. We're a dark site deployment into their most...
So you're flexible. You can go on-premise.
Correct. We can
in the cloud.
We can support mainframe through to RDS databases and AWS. We support multiple different models from EKS and ECS deployments. We're very flexible on that. But the idea, because of the privilege we have around where we deploy our agents, is it allows us to create...
How's it like working with Amazon? They obviously had Marketplace. It was a market-making opportunity for you. You got in the market. You got some sales. Now you got field developing. Yeah. You engaging with their partner network. Is that kind of where you guys are partnering with them on?
Yes. So we drank the Kool-Aid on the co-build, co-market, co-sell, and it's worked. So majority of our customers have been inbound, as I was saying. They're looking for a solution, or AWS has recommended us into them. And Marketplace has allowed us to transact in some weird and wonderful places globally where we don't have a company presence, including like the US as an example. We now have a bank account and a presence here, but our first transactions were 100% through Marketplace.
Yeah, that's a dream scenario. Okay, what's one of your goals this year? Obviously, you're going to fly back to New Zealand, get the team there. Are you going to expand, stay lean and mean? Are you guys... like very operationally leveraged perfectly? I mean, or is there expansion?
Yeah, there's expansion. There's further development doing around unstructured data, which we're super excited about, and some customers are testing that now. We are building out the team, the go-to-market team, so building that out here in the US particularly. And then, doubling down on product. The AI agents particularly gives us whole new opportunity around how to leverage data.
The data cleaning could be automated completely,
big
and simulations. What'd you think of the event summit this year? It felt like a little mini reInvent, a lot of action. What was your takeaway?
Yeah, I've been to a few summits. This was number one, and the energy. I think, you know, what Swami's announcements around Agent Core, I think they're smashing it at the moment. There was a real buzz around.
I mean, if they're announcing this at Summit,
what's
reInvent going to look like?
Yeah.
I mean, I know I can read Amazon like a book. They're not going to just do this and then not have they're not going to lay an egg at reInvent. if this is what their pre-games.
Yeah, that's right. This was huge.
This was halftime report, we called it, on our program, because so much has happened this year. It's like, normally the years are like awesome and reInvents a slew of announcements and then sets the agenda for the next year. I mean, this basically, I talked to Matt Garman about this when I had one of them. It's like a half a year, feels like a year. More CapEx, ton of global expansion, the regions, sovereignty's coming up as a huge issue. Just how agents are coming in, changing the stack and the value creation, extraction equation. It's unbelievable.
They are moving faster. They are, the pace that they're moving at is quite incredible for this.
All right, so next year when you're back in for summit, are you going to be at reInvent?
100%.
Okay, we'll see you at reInvent. So reInvent, what do you think is going to happen in the second half of the year? What's your prediction in terms of industry? What do you think is going to happen? People are going to be certainly buzzing about agents, but knowing what you know coming out of the summit, what are you seeing into the second half? What's going to happen?
Look, I think
when we see each other at reInvent, we'll
compare notes. But I mean, it's almost like LLMs are an old world now. We've moving so fast now. What we're going to start seeing is some epic use case of agents in market that are operating, and everyone has two or three agents that are personally and at work that are just enhancing the workforce. So I think everyone can 10x.
Will the buzz of MCP be better and bigger by reInvent, or is it going to that taper down, or that's going to be?
A2A. I mean, we I think
what do you like better, A2A or MCP?
MCP is what we've gone for.
Yeah.
Is what we're using, and so. But yeah, I mean, again, protocols change.
They're not exactly the same. I mean, it's overlap between A2A and MCP,
correct.
But
yeah. I think for us, it's the ability to give customers to swap out models that they want to be using, which is why we've gone sort of MCP, and obviously A2A is when we're going to be having these multiple agents and conversing and working together and orchestrating.
Well, the Linux Foundation has this work cut out for it, because when you have momentum like MCP in these organic, you know, de facto protocol kind of, you know, group decisions, which is essentially what happened, it's hard to undo that. In my opinion, when you start to see these protocols, I mean, look at TCP/IP.
Yeah.
I mean, that was never supposed to happen that way. It's like that was in the 80s. That's where I grew up generation. But so I like that protocol buy. I think Ethernet was supposed to not be around.
Yeah,
like a zillion terabits per second coming soon. Well, Grant, great to have you on. Excited.
Thanks,
congratulations. Thanks for coming to
the
CUBE.
Appreciate the opportunity.
Here at our NYSE studio, plus the CUBE, plus NYSE is really the Wired community. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks, John.
Okay, more coverage here for the AI Cloud Week. Of course, AWS had their big event this week in New York City. This is theCUBE. I'm John Furrier, your host. Thanks for watching.